everyone, welcome back to my channel. I'm Andrea. It's nice to have you guys here. Today we've got a Q&A. I haven't done a Q&A since Vlogtober, I think. I decided to kind of relocate to a more comfortable corner for the Q&A. I just kind of wanted it to feel like you're just hanging out here in my apartment. Getting into the questions, I've got a fair amount of questions. So the first question was from, I don't know if it's HMM101 a lot or 101 a lot, but I know they're one of my subscribers and followers on both here and on Instagram, so we've been chatting a bit. So hello, and their question two, number one, what do you want the outcome of your PhD to be, for example, career-wise? And two, what products are you noticing the most positive difference from using lately? I'm going to answer the second one first because that's a lot easier. But I have one of them here because it's part of what's in my monthly favorites, so spoiler. You know it's going to be an Eminence product for me, and it's the Strawberry Rhubarb Hyaluronic Serum. This is amazing, and I definitely am noticing the benefit from the hyaluronic acid in it, as well as from, there's honey in this, which is great for acne-prone skin like I have. There's rhubarb and aloe, and like there's a whole bunch of things packed into this. I've been using this every day, so a little goes a really long way, and you know when you've used too much. The other product that I've noticed a huge difference is also by Eminence, and that's their facial recovery oil. And that, I just need 2 drops. My skin is so happy. So definitely noticing a positive difference from using both of those. And then the first question, the outcome of my PhD, I want a job. I'm trying not to be too picky because I have student loans. I think right now I'm just so concerned about finding a job that will pay my bills and pay my student loans. I should be able to do that. And I haven't started really looking at postings, so I don't have a really accurate sense of what my options are going to be like. I think once I do, I probably will need to start narrowing things down a little bit. I would like to still be a professor. I love teaching. I love working with my students. But I'm also open to what we call ALTAC, or alternate academia. And that would be positions that require a PhD or an academic background, but are not traditional teaching and research jobs. So there's a number of things. You know, I'd love to work in museums. I think being a curator or a curatorial assistant would be really cool. I'd love working in an archive. Yeah, stuff like that. Anything that would like be in that kind of general area, I think would be really fun. And of course, as a lot of you know, I'm really focusing on looking for jobs overseas, specifically in the UK. So yeah, I feel like my decision, I'm open to do, this is such a long rambly answer. I'm open to doing a lot of different things. So I feel like my decision is probably going to come down to, number one is, I think, work-life balance and like what I actually enjoy it, what I want to do it for, like 50 to 60 hours a week. Because does anyone work a 40-hour work week anymore? So like I hopefully would like what I'm doing. Second, the salary. It needs to pay my bills and it needs to help me pay off my student loans. And third, probably location. And so with those three factors in mind, whether it's teaching, whether it's at a university, a museum, a nonprofit, whether it's a corporate type job, if those other three factors are there, if it's a location I want, if the salary is good, and if it seems generally like a job I would enjoy, I'm open to it. I feel like that doesn't fully answer your question about what I want the outcome of my PhD to be, but I think even though graduation is now less than a year away, hypothetically, assuming I get everything done in time, it still doesn't quite feel real yet, and I'm still trying to stay as open as possible to as many options as possible, if that makes sense. So I think over the next several months, and definitely within the next year, you guys are going to see me making a more specific choice, but right now I'm just open to so much. Next question is from Nadia Kaur, who also has a YouTube channel. You should go check her out. Her question for the Q&A, in your experience, what are the pros and cons of being a YouTuber? Let's start with cons, because I feel like that's a shorter list. Cons are the occasional really rude, nasty comment. I've only gotten two that were so bad that I just deleted them right away. Like, that used foul language and were just really mean and calling me horrible things. And that's only happened a couple times, which twice in a little over a year, I'll take those odds. But other than that, there really aren't any cons. I mean, it is time consuming, but to me that's not a con, because to me it's worth it to take the time to do it. So pros for me are definitely the community, the people, the friends that I've made. You know, I just think the community of other channels, but also the community within my own channel and my subscribers is just amazing. And I love, love, love all of you wonderful people that I've gotten to meet. So I'd say that's probably the biggest pro. But also, I feel like I've gotten a lot more confident in some ways. There's something about having to look at your face and listen to your voice week after week as you're editing. I feel like it's made me become a lot less self-critical. Because in the beginning, I was noticing that I was editing out a lot of really mean things that I was saying about myself that I would never say to someone else. And so hearing that back just made me so much more aware of how critical I was being of myself. And I still have my moments, but it's definitely got me to kind of knock that off a bit. So I'd say that's the becoming less critical of myself and the community are probably the two biggest pros. So good question, Nadia, thank you. From Marie from End the Color Green. Her question, any pics or stories about when you did costume design? Let me know in the comments if you guys would like a dedicated video on, like, costume design story time. I can try to do that. Gosh, to tell a quick story, there are many quick stories. The pictures that I know I can find are from Drowsy Chaperone, and I think there's a blog post. I'll try to put a few pictures in here, then I'll also try to link the blog post down below, and then you guys let me know if you want to hear more about all of this, because I can do more stories and more pictures. But Drowsy Chaperone is a kind of a musical set within a story. So it's a guy in his apartment listening to a record of a Broadway musical, and the musical kind of comes to life on stage. It's a massive show. There's a ton of quick changes, including one that is, I think it's five different looks just in that one number. And they're almost all happening on stage. And it was a huge challenge to kind of figure out how we were going to do these changes. Thankfully, I had two amazing assistant designers who were helping me on that show. But yeah, it was intense. But we pulled it off, and it looked really good, and we were working with the choreographer, and so there were definitely some kind of magical moments on stage. I think my favorite costume from that show, though, was a blue dress that we made for one of the female leads, and it was just this that set in the 1920s, and so it was just a kind of dropped waist but then these petal skirt panels, just gorgeous. And in the song and dance number, it's probably the closest I'll get to like designing a Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers type project. So I loved it. And then the end of the musical, four of the characters get married, and so we had to come up with four wedding dresses. Yeah, that was fun. We rented one, but we made three. We made three wedding dresses for that show. I just about died. It's still not as bad as the Scarlet Pimpernel, though, so the Drowsy Chaperone was relatively painless compared to the Scarlet Pimpernel. So let me know in the comments if you want to hear more about the Scarlet Pimpernel and other stories. So the next question is by Belinda Laurie. Hi, Belinda! I miss you on YouTube. So she asked a few questions. Four questions. Okay, we're gonna go through these one at a time and hope I don't take a million hours. If you had to choose only three beauty products to live with, what would they be? Are we talking like individual products or like general categories of products? If I had to choose three products, okay, I'm gonna break the rule a bit and do four, but if I really had to like narrow it down, I would want my probiotic cleanser from Eminence, because I need a cleanser. I would need a moisturizer of some kind. I'd probably go with the overnight recovery oil, because it has moisturizing properties, but it also has other good stuff. And then I need a lip balm I need a lip balm of some kind. Like, I cannot function if my lips feel dry. And then if I were allowed to pick a fourth product, like if we're literally saying these are the only ones I could have, I'd need a mascara. Please let me have a mascara. I feel like I'd look a bit weird without mascara, but I technically could live without mascara. But I would need a good cleanser, some kind of good moisturizer, and a lip balm. Those would be kind of my top three. What role do you think academic institutions play today? Do you consider them to be at the forefront of discussion given the rise of social media? Jeez, Belinda. Okay, well, this is a whole video in itself, I feel. Maybe that's what I might do. Because that's a really good question. I'm going to skip to question number three because I feel like two and four kind of go together. So question number three is, if you could give your younger self advice, what would you tell her? Do not be so hard on yourself. Ignore the boys, because boys are stupid when you're young. None of the boys that you had access to when you were a teenager deserved you anyway. So just don't even bother worrying about it. Like, I kind of knew that when I was younger, but I still wasted a lot of time worrying about it. But I think the biggest thing is probably to not be so hard on myself. I was not kind to my younger self. And I look back at my younger self and I just wish I could go back and give her a big hug because she kind of needed it. So yeah, don't pay attention to other people. Don't compare yourself. And then question four was, do you think university is a good route for today's youth? And so I think that kind of does play into what role do academic institutions play today. I do like the question, do you consider them to be at the forefront of discussion given the rise of social media? So there is a lot of discussion among both my more immediate academic circles, like my grad school friends, but also within larger, like, academic websites. Like, this is a topic of conversation, is with social media and with there being so much criticism, especially these days, this kind of backlash against the intellectual elite. I do find myself struggling with friends who do have certain political views, trying to make myself and my opinion be heard and be understood without being automatically dismissed because, oh, I'm just, you know, an intellectual elitist. I think I'm so smart because I'm doing a PhD. Like, no, I have a valid opinion on these things, and my opinions are backed up by legitimate research and statistics. But what a lot of us academics are struggling with when you're looking at the discussions on social media is how do we provide an alternate perspective without sounding like we're just being a bunch of snobs? This is such a complicated question for a Q&A. Skipping a little bit to, do I think university is a good route for today's youth? I mean, the whole question, should you go to college? Short answer is it depends, which is a very academic answer to give. I always tell students, you know, figure out what you want to do. What do you want to do with your life? Where do you see yourself going as your career? And then talk to people who do that and ask them how they got there. If they went to college, I mean, there are some careers, if you want to be a doctor or a lawyer, you're going to need the medical degree. You're going to need the law degree. I think if university were free, I would say, hell yes, go to university, get your bachelor's degree, have that experience, take all the classes. But I feel like there's so much focus on the money these days. Students are spending obscene amounts of money on their college education, and the degrees they're getting still aren't enough. This is a whole other video. I am gonna, like, highlight these questions, Belinda, and I will probably come back to these in another Tuesday video, because I feel like I need to just put something down a little bit more, like, bullet-pointed list. Really interesting questions and really, really important. Next question. So you guys are asking so many good questions. This one is from Stefan Barnard. He's one of my UK subscribers. Hello. And he had three questions. Question number one, he says, I know you are a fan of Escape to the Country, and the county of Devon caught your eye recently. Do you have plans one day to maybe visit this part of the UK or any other county? I think if I ever managed to move to the UK, I probably would spend like one weekend a month doing like a B&B trip to the different counties and different parts, because there's just so many beautiful parts of all of the UK that I really would like to explore. I don't have hard plans, like I don't have solid plans, but like long-term plans, I'm hoping this next trip coming up, I'm hoping to go visit some of my other YouTuber friends near where they live. And yeah, I feel like I've really, and I do want to go back to Bath. So yeah, I do want to visit more of the UK and more of the different counties. His second question is, how long have Gus and Luna been part of your family? I would love to know their story. Luna, we've had a while. Our first dog, Lucy, had passed away while I was doing my first master's degree. And they waited a little while, but then they kind of wanted a new dog. My dad rides the commuter bus with some people that volunteer for the Arizona Lab and Giant Breed Rescue. My dad really wanted a black lab or a lab of some kind. My parents had a black lab named McDuff back when they first got married. We tried out a dog named Cody. The rescue group was great. They let you kind of have the dog spend the night, spend a few nights, and see how it adjusts to your home, because they don't want to adopt a dog to a family that it's not going to work. So we had Cody, and Cody didn't work well with the cat, our cat Taffy, that we had at the time. He was very fixated on her, and not in a good way. The poor cat just ended up trapped in the laundry room, and Cody would literally sit at the door to the laundry room. We had a gate that only the cat could get through, and it just was making us nervous. And my parents had looked at Luna before on the website, but when they called, she had already been adopted, so we, you know, decided to try out Cody. And then we realized Cody wasn't going to work, and so the rescue took Cody back and said, well, Luna has been returned. She didn't work out with the family that was trying to adopt her. And so we thought, well, great, well, let's try Luna. She came in, and she was just such a happy dog, and she was just so happy to be there. She took one look at Taffy, and Taffy hissed at her, and Luna's just like, huh, okay, and off she went. We were like, okay, this one, I think Luna's gonna work, because Luna just didn't care about Taffy. She was perfectly happy to just ignore the cat. She wasn't trying to chase her, but they eventually became really good friends and would kind of sleep on the same bed together, which never happened with Lucy. Yeah, so that's how we got Luna. Gus is actually my sister's dog, but he stays at my parents' house during the day so that the dogs can kind of keep each other company while my sister and my parents are at work. And he was rescued through another group. Yeah, Lisa found him online and rescued him. He's only got one eye. He's fine, but he can't see. He's blind in the one eye. So we've got some pretty funny stories with that. He's such a derpy little dog, but he's adorable and he loves to cuddle, as you guys have seen in the vlogs. And then Stefan's third question is, and lastly, how is your London countdown going? Please. He said 130, 130 maybe, LOL, and this was about a week ago. So the current countdown, we are now at 114 days as of July 2nd when I'm filming this. Add one more, because it's 114 days until the day I fly. So it's 115 until the day I land in London, because I fly overnight. So next question is from Alice. If you had an unlimited budget, what would you change about your filming setup, if anything? If I had an unlimited budget, oh gosh. I'd get Final Cut Pro on my new laptop. I'd get two softbox lights and a ring light. I'd get a new DSLR so that I wouldn't have to film on my Olympus Pen. And I'd probably get a couple lenses. I don't know which ones. I'd have to research lenses. Like right now, it's so far out of what I'm able to afford right now that I really don't know specific lenses. But I think I would want probably a couple different types of lenses. I love filming on the Olympus Pen for these videos, but I think it would be nice to have a more dedicated filming setup so that the pen could be like just my vlogging camera. That's a good question, Alice. Thank you. It's fun to think about. I wish I had an unlimited budget. Pages and Polish, Shannon asks, if you were stranded on a desert island and you can bring any character from any book for company, who are you bringing? Am I intentionally stranded? Like, do I want to be stranded on this island, or do I want off the island? I think I might go with Captain Wentworth from Persuasion. Because he's a Navy guy, so he's probably good with, like, the sea. And he'd probably be good if he was stranded on an island. Like, he'd probably be good at the whole survival bit. But we'd probably also have a lot of, I mean, do I really want, like, a 19th century gentleman stranded on an island with me? We might spend the time, like, reciting poetry. Oh, gosh. I'm gonna say Tom Hiddleston's character from The Night Manager, just because presumably then it would be Tom Hiddleston or someone who looks like him, and yeah, that wouldn't be bad. Okay, moving on to the next question. Tamsin Lena. Tamsin's one of my really good friends on here. Her question is, where do you see yourself in 5 years? For example, job-wise, location, YouTube, dot, dot, dot. 5 years, hopefully I've got a job. What's weird is, you know, 5 years ago, it would have been like, writing my dissertation and nearing the end of my PhD, and now 5 years just feel like I have no idea, because for so long my future was just my degree and finishing my degree, and now I have no idea where I'm gonna get a job. I have no idea where I'm living. My ideal situation, if I could have my pick, if I could choose my answer and it would magically come true, 5 years from now I would love to be a professor at a university in the London area, or if I could get a job working somewhere like the Victoria and Albert Museum, that would just be incredible. So like, job-wise, that would be like my preference. Location, living in London or the London area. YouTube, 5 years. Hopefully I've hit at least 1,000 subscribers by then. I feel like that's kind of my one goal with YouTube. I would like to one day hit 1,000 subscribers, and I don't think that's completely unattainable for me at the rate my channel has been going. I do think it will happen one day. I don't see myself giving up my channel unless there was just an amazing job that I was being offered, but they were telling me that YouTube is a conflict of interest and I can't do it if I do the job. That would be the only reason I would stop doing YouTube. Otherwise, I think my channel might change as my life changes, but I think I can't see myself stopping doing this. So yeah, that's the ideal scenario of where I see myself in 5 years. We'll see. And I think that actually might be the last question. If I didn't answer your question for some reason, if YouTube is hiding it from me, I'm very sorry. Thank you all for so many amazing questions. You guys make these Q&As so much fun. Yeah, give the video a thumbs up if you liked it. Thank you all for being awesome. Say hi down in the comments. Subscribe if you're not subscribed, and I will see you all very soon in the next video. Thank you very much for watching. Bye-bye.